Hello students, in today's video we are going to see the 11th chapter from your English course book, Japan and Brazil Through a Traveler's Eye, written by George Mikes. Before going into the video, if anyone is seeing the channel for the first time or if you have not subscribed to my channel, please do subscribe and share it with your friends, and also click the bell button to receive notifications whenever I upload new videos. So without wasting time, let us get into the video. So as I said, the chapter's name is Japan and Brazil Through a Traveler's Eye, and it is written by George Mikes. Now let us see a few points about the author. George Mikes, he was from Hungary, and he was an artist, author, publisher, journalist, etc. And he studied law and received his doctorate from the Budapest University. So George Mikes received his doctorate from Budapest University, and he has written a number of books such as The Hungarian Revolution, How to Be an Artist, How to Be Inimitable, How to Tango, The Land of Rising Sun. So like that, he has written a lot of books. And the chapter which you have to learn, these are excerpts from his books, The Land of Rising Yen and How to Tango. So what is excerpts means? That is, excerpts means they are a short extract from his writing. Okay, short extract. Okay, that means this chapter which you have to learn is a short part from these two books. These two books fully are not given for you, but a small part from that you have to learn. And in your chapter, you have to learn about two parts. One, you have to learn about Japan, that is Japanese manners. That part is taken from the book The Land of Rising Yen. And after that, you have to learn about traffic in Brazil. That part is taken from the book How to Tango. So like that, this chapter is excerpts from his two books, Land of Rising Yen and How to Tango. And George Mikes, about him if we say, he is known for his humorous commentaries on countries. That is, he usually write humorous commentaries. Humorous commentaries, that is like funny commentaries, and these funny commentaries usually he write about countries. The same thing here also about Japan and Brazil. So he usually write humorous commentaries about countries. So that is what we have to understand about the author George Mikes. So that is the main points about George Mikes. Now let us move on to the first part of this chapter. That is, first we have to understand what is travel writing. Okay, travel writing. See, travel writing is about writing one's experience of traveling and visiting alien places. So this is a separate style of writing, and this travel writing explains about the person's visit to alien places. Alien places means unknown places or foreign countries. That is what is alien places. Someone goes to an unknown place and writes about that. That is a travel writing. As a genre of writing, it is as old as 2nd century, when travelers to Greece recorded their experience in the form of diary. So it started very early, as old as 2nd century. That time, to travelers to Greece, they recorded their experience in the form of diary. They used to note down in their diary their experiences. So that was the early form of travel writing. Okay, so it was started very early, travel writing. And while the inventions of new techniques of navigation and sea voyages during the 9th and 10th centuries, travel writing became popular and more number of people began to explore new places on the globe. So when new inventions, new techniques, navigation, everything started to come, then travel writing became even more famous. So navigation techniques, new techniques of traveling, all these came, people became more interested in travel writing, and people started to explore new places, and thus travel writing became even more famous. Soon, such trips started getting royal patronage and support. So these travels started getting royal patronage. That is, the kings started supporting. We can say they started funding, giving money, giving all support to these travelers. So kings' support also encouraged travel. New adventures and voyages were even commissioned. So thus, travel writing ceased to be just a description of a new place born out of curiosity and gained political overtones. So till then, till the king started supporting, it was just that they will go to some place and write about that place. But after that, it became even more serious. So travel writing became even more serious after the king started to give them royal patronage. Now, even after much of the earth has been explored and almost every piece on this earth has been written about, its popularity has not waned, as can be seen by the immense viewership it has on modern media like TV and internet. So here it is said that almost all of the earth has been explored, but even then people are still interested in traveling and knowing about places. People have a lot of interest in seeing about the places, because now also if you see modern media like TV and internet, there are so many travel programs, and people are very much interested to see such programs. So that means people are still very much interested in seeing or exploring places and writing about places. It is seen how we can understand that even now in TV or internet, people are still following travel programs. Now, its popularity has not waned. Not waned means it has not decreased. Popularity has not waned. That means the popularity of such things has not decreased. Sorry, the popularity has not still decreased. Why? Because the people are still showing so much interested in such program. Decreased. Okay. So now let us move on to the next paragraph. Travel writing has come under serious scholarly study in the past 50 years. Now, travel writing has become very important. That this travel writing has become a part of cultural studies program in many universities. People have started to study about travel writing in many universities. That much it has become serious. Travel writing is no longer viewed as a product of some innocent curiosity or an attempt to understand an alien culture objectively. So now travel writing is not considered to be just a product of curiosity, but these are now like narratives telling comments on how culture gets represented by another. So now in travel writing, we can find about different cultures. If, for example, a person goes to a country, that person writes about that place culture or that the living style, cultural values, all these things we can understand from travel writing. So these narratives are telling comments on how culture gets represented by one another, and in the process subtly uphold some cultural values as somehow superior and universal than the others. So here you can even compare one country, which is we can compare two countries, which country's values are better, which country's culture is better. So all these things we can get from travel writing. So here we are just trying to understand how important travel writing is. In the beginning, it started just like a person going to a foreign place or an unknown place and writing commentaries about the place. But now it has become a part of studies in some universities, and it helps us to know about the culture and values of different places. So this is the introduction about travel writing. So now we are directly moving into the lesson. So the first part we are going to study today, that is Japanese manners. So we are going to learn about the first part here, that is Japanese manners. Okay. A quarter of an hour in Japan will convince you that you are among exquisitely well-mannered people. A quarter of an hour, that is for 15 minutes, if you just go or stay in Japan, it will convince you. It will convince you means it will make you believe. What it will make you believe? That you are among exquisitely well-mannered people. That is, it will make you believe that you are among one of the best mannered people. Well-mannered people. They have very good manners. You are among the exquisitely well-mannered people. People who live on a hopelessly overcrowded island have to respect one another's privacy, or rather would have to if they had any privacy. See, Japan is an overcrowded island. It is an overcrowded place. Okay, even though it is an overcrowded place, overcrowded place, the people have to respect one another's privacy. Okay, but the problem is, but they don't. Why? Because it is not very easy to get privacy in an overcrowded place. Imagine to get privacy in an overcrowded place. It is not possible. But they don't. So courtesy has a double function. So it is not at all possible. So what is happening here? Courtesy. Courtesy means basically politeness or giving respect to each other. Politeness has a double function here. And what is the double function? It is courtesy and it is substitute to privacy. So here privacy is not there. Instead of privacy, privacy has a substitute. Okay, substitute means in place of the other. So in place of privacy, they have courtesy. So simple thing, in Japan it is so overcrowded that they are basically well-mannered people. But it is not possible to have privacy in such an overcrowded place. So instead of privacy, privacy has a substitute, that is, there is something in place of privacy, that is courtesy or politeness. So that is what the author is trying to tell in the first part. Now let us move on to the next sentence. Take for example, so here the author is trying to make it more clear by giving an example. Take for example the little red telephones in the streets. So he says that there are little red telephones in the streets. Okay, in the streets. And these telephones in streets, shops, halls of hotels, many places these telephones are there. The instrument is situated on a table. This red telephone is situated on a table or on a counter, like in a reception area or on a table. This red telephone is there, and they have no space to spare for booth. Okay, not in booths. So I think you must have seen telephone booths. Okay, telephone booths. Before and all, there were so many STD, ISD booths. So it was just like a small room. Why there was a small room and there one telephone was kept? Because if it was in a booth, we can talk privately. That is, anything, personal things and all, we can stand and talk inside the booth. But in Japan, these red telephones are there in streets, they are there in shops, are there in hotels. And everywhere it is either kept on a table or on the counter. That is, in between all the people, we have to stand and make the call. There is no privacy at all. Why? Because they don't have place to make booths. It is so overcrowded, there is no place to make booths. So the instrument is situated on a table or on a counter. They have no space to spare for booth. You conduct your most confidential business transactions, that is, whatever private things you have to speak, your confidential business transaction, your intimate love quarrels in public. So if you are talking to your lover, that also you have to talk in public because there is no booth. It is kept on a table or on a counter in the street or shops. Or if you have to talk about your business transactions, all you have to do in public, yet perfect privacy, yet in perfect privacy. So how do they get privacy even though they are speaking in between everyone? So here they are telling that anybody, any passerby could listen in, but nobody does. So the privacy here is anybody could listen. See, naturally, if you are talking standing in the center of a street, anybody could hear you. But what the author is telling, nobody does, but no one will do it. Anybody can hear, but nobody does. No one will hear it. A man's telephone receiver is his castle. That is, that earphone of the or earpiece of the telephone is your castle. Like it is like your palace. You are standing inside your palace and you are talking. Like that, you have to think and you have to stand in the center of the street and talk. But anyone can listen. But in Japan, he is telling that no one will do that. No one will try to listen to what you are speaking. Okay, so that is the speciality of Japan. That is why he is saying that they are well mannered. You will of course immediately notice their mania for bowing. So again, the next thing he is telling, they have a kind of a mania. That is, they have a kind of, they are just obsessed with something. Okay, they are just obsessed with something. What is that obsession which they have? They are obsessed with bowing. What is bowing? That is bending forward your head and body. You are bending your head and body, like in respect, you bow in front of someone. That is, they have a mania. They are obsessed with bowing. Everybody keeps bowing to everybody else. Okay, there is nothing like who has to, everybody keeps on bowing. This mania, why it is called mania? Because everybody keeps on bowing. Everybody keeps on bowing to everybody else with ceremonious solemnity of a courtier, yet with a great deal of natural and inimitable grace. So this bowing they do it in a very ceremonial way, okay, in a very dignified way, in a very respectful, a dignified way, yet with a great deal of natural and inimitable grace. That is, inimitable means which cannot be imitated. Inimitable, it cannot be imitated. Such a grace they have, and they bow in front of everyone. Bowing is neither less nor more silly than shaking hands. See, according to the author, bowing is just a very silly thing. It is not less silly, neither less nor more silly than shaking hands. You know, some people when they meet each other, they shake hands. Shaking hands is a mannerism. Or they kiss on their cheeks. Some people greet each other by kissing on cheeks. So it is almost the same like that, bowing for Japanese. It is neither less nor more silly than shaking hands or kissing cheeks. So that is what here the author is trying to tell. So here, bowing is neither less nor more silly than shaking hands or kissing cheeks. But it is quainter, more formal, more oriental. So what the author is telling, the difference here is, in Japan, bowing is more quainter. So here he says that bowing is more quainter. What do you mean by quainter? Quainter is a kind of old-fashioned, okay? It is a kind of old-fashioned thing. And more formal, it is formal, very official. And more oriental. Oriental means it is a more of an eastern thing, not western. See, shaking hands and kissing on cheeks and all, western countries do more. But here bowing is more quainter, formal, oriental, that is old-fashioned, a kind of eastern style. And it is also infectious. So he says four things about bowing. Infectious means it is, you can transmit, okay, transmit it from one to another, transmit from one to another. So that is the speciality of bowing, which the author says. So he says that it is quainter, more formal, more oriental, and it is also infectious. Why he says it is infectious? He is telling that after a few hours, you start bowing yourselves. You stay in Japan for some time, you see everyone bowing to each other. After some time, you also naturally start bowing yourselves. That is why it is said that it is infectious. But you bow too deeply or not too deeply enough. You bow to the wrong man at wrong time. You do not clasp your hands in front of you, which is bad, or you do, which is worse. See, so bowing has some rules. So here, bowing has some rules. See, it should not be like you bow too deeply, or sometimes not too deeply, or you bow to the wrong man at wrong time, or you do not clasp, that is, or you do not grip your hands tightly in front of you, that is bad, or you do, which is worse. See, there are some rules for bowing. So what are these rules which in Japan they follow for bowing? You will discover that Japanese have a complicated hierarchy of bowing. So Japanese have a complicated hierarchy for bowing. So what is the complicated hierarchy for bowing in Japan? So let us see that complicated hierarchy of bowing. That is, there are some rules like who bows to whom. So who should bow to whom? That is one thing which they should think. And how deeply you should bow. How deeply, that is how much you should bend. Okay, you should not bend too much. You should not bend, what to say, more or less. And for how long and how deeply and how long you should stand like that bending. So there are some rules or complicated hierarchy. Hierarchy means there is a kind of ranking. Okay, there is a kind of ranking for this bowing in Japan. One of the American states had an early traffic law which laid down that if two cars met at an intersection, neither was to move before the other had gone. So now the author is just trying to make a sarcasm or making a funny statement, and what he's telling that one of the American states, he's telling about one of the American states, they had an early traffic rule. And according to that traffic rule, if two cars met an intersection, imagine two cars, they met at an intersection. Okay, intersection is a place where two or more roads meet. So if two cars come face to face at an intersection, it is said that neither was to move before the other had gone. Neither can move before the other. So what is the author meaning by this? Neither can move. That means both of them cannot move. Not the one nor the another. They cannot move before the other. So what is the meaning? Both have to stand there only. So it was something which was not possible. So he's just making fun and he's telling that one of the American states had an early traffic law which laid down that if two cars met an intersection, neither was to move before the other had gone. So like that, he just makes a sarcasm and then he comes back to Japan and he tells that similarly, if two Japanese bow, imagine if two Japanese bow to each other, neither is to straighten up before the other. That is, neither straightens before the other. So how can it be possible? First one should stand straight, then only the other can do. So both will have to wait. So neither has to, not one nor the another can straighten before the other. So what is the meaning? Both have to stand like that only. So it is a little complicated to us. So after telling these two examples, he's telling if we think of these things, we will feel, how is it going to happen? So he only says it is a little complicated to us, but they manage it without difficulty. Even though it is complicated for us, complicated to us, they manage. They means here, Japanese manage to do it. Somehow they manage to do this. So I don't, the author is telling, don't know how it is a little complicated to us. Even then, they manage it without difficulty. and even the smallest difference in rank. So they do it without any difficulty. Now again he says that smallest difference in rank, standing age, social position, all will be subtly reflected in that split second. So that means, in I told you there are some rules and regulations, there is a hierarchy, there is some ranking, who has to bow before whom, how much time they should bow, and who should come straight first. So there are so much rules. So he is telling that if there is a small difference in rank, age, position, all these will be subtly, that is delicately, that will be reflected, and this will be reflected in split second. So imagine one person is seeing the another. In that split second, we have to see the other person and we have to understand their age, their position, everything. And reflected in the split second, one man's bow is shorter than the others. So they understand it very easily. Japanese, so basically the author is trying to tell that Japanese very easily in a split second understands, as soon as they see a person, they understand without any difficulty. What they understand, the rank of that person, the age of that person, social position of that person, everything very easily they understand. We cannot understand it, but they understand. So now in a Japanese family, there are some basic rules for bowing. Okay, there are some basic rules for bowing. That is, wife bows to her husband. If in a family, wife bows to her husband, that is one rule. Child bows to father, child to father. Then younger brother bows to elder brother, younger brother to elder brother. And the sisters bows to all brothers of whatever age. So if it is a girl child, sisters have to bow to brothers whatever age they are. If a brother is younger also, she has to bow to her brother. So like this, in family, these rules are followed. Wives bows to her husband, sisters to brothers, child to father, younger brother to elder brother. So all these rules are followed in families in Japan. And then the author is telling that, I saw babies carried in Japanese style on their mother's back. See, usually we have seen Japanese women carrying babies on their back. Okay, babies in a kind of a cloth bag, they tie it to their back. Okay, so I have seen Japanese women carrying, or mothers carrying their babies to their back, and carried in Japanese style on their mother's backs in a clever little saddles. That is, a clever little saddles means it's some kind of a bag. And whenever mothers bowed, so what happens is this: when a mother is seeing someone and when mother is bowing, naturally babies are on their back. So what will happen? Whenever mothers bowed, babies also bowed. Okay, because they are tied to their mother's back. Okay, babies also bow. Somewhat condensedly from his majestic height. So what is it? The baby's bow, like it is kind of a rule, from his majestic height. Japanese stores employ bowing girls who stand at the top of escalators and whose only duty is to bow deeply. So there are in Japanese, if you have Japanese stores or shops, okay, in stores, there are some girls who are just hired for bowing. They are called as bowing girls. They just stand in the entrance or at the top of the escalator, that is staircase, they stand, and their only duty is just to bow deeply to everyone and sundry, that is Japanese equivalent to our page boys, that is the person who keeps opening and closing the door. So their just duty is to bow in front of everyone. So for that they hire Japanese girls in stores. On the famous and fast Tokyado line between Tokyo and Osaka. So here they are telling about a line between two places, that is Tokyo and Osaka. So it is a mode of transportation between these two places. Two conductors enter the carriage in a slight theatrical scene. So as soon as the person enters the bus or train, so what they will see is the two conductors. There are two conductors. Okay, two conductors. They come inside the carriage. Inside the carriage, they come inside in a slightly theatrical scene, like in drama and all. They come, no, like that. They come inside. They march to the middle of the coach. These two conductors come. They march like the army people march. No, they march to the middle of the coach and they bow ceremoniously. And what they do? They bow in front of everyone in both directions, to left side also and right side also. They bow. After that, they start their duty, that is checking tickets. Conductors check tickets. So after that, they start checking ticket. So in Tokyo and Tokyo-Edo line between Tokyo and Osaka, these conductors enter the carriage. They enter in a drama style. They march in the middle of the coach and they bow ceremoniously in both directions and then start checking the tickets. So that is that much importance they give to bowing. That much we told, you know, they are very polite, well-mannered people. That much importance they give. In one of the parts of Nara, now again he is making a humorous statement. The author is making a humorous statement. So what he is saying is, once he went to parts of Nara. Nara is a place, okay? He went to Nara and I met a deer. So there it is kind of a forest kind of a place maybe. There he met a deer and I bought a pack of food for him. He is telling that I went to Nara and there I met a deer, and for that deer, for giving to that deer, I bought a pack of food. And what happened is, this deer came up to me, looked into my eyes and bowed deeply. Okay, so here he is telling that he is just humorously making fun and telling that this animal came to me and looked into my eyes, and this animal bowed in front, this deer bowed in front of me. It bowed deeply. It was no chance gesture. He is telling that it was not by chance and all it did. It was a proper and courteous bow. Very respectfully, it bowed in front of me. And what the author is telling, he is telling that the deer, perhaps he is telling the deer is more imitative than I know. That is, he is telling that maybe the deer is trying to imitate the people in Japan. It is a Japanese deer, no? So maybe it is imitating. It is more imitative than I knew. Perhaps if they see people bowing all the time, they get into the habit too. He is telling, if someone, even an animal, sees the people bowing full time, maybe this animal also have got the habit. Or perhaps it is something genetic. Or he is telling, perhaps it is genetic because it is the blood of a Japanese deer, no? From Japan only the deer is. That is why maybe in his blood only it is there. That is why this deer came and bowed in front of me. I do not know. I don't know. Maybe. But the deer came and bowed in front of me. I do not know. But I do know that deer bowed to me. After bowing in front of me, the deer did something. That is, it jumped at me, snatched the little foot bag from my hand. After bowing, it jumped at me and snatched the food bag. Snatched the bag of food. So that is what happened. Beginning and all, full respect it showed, but after that it snatched the food bag from my hand. So like this, the author is trying to make a humorous statement about the habit of Japanese bowing always. After that, he is telling that in this too, the deer was a true Japanese. So he told that the deer bowed in front of me, after that jumped and took the bag. So he is telling that in this habit also, the deer is a true Japanese. So what is he telling about a Japanese person? That he is explaining here. You can often see people bowing to each other with ceremonious serenity at bus stop. So if you go to bus stop and all in Japan, the author is telling, as soon as people see each other, people will very respectfully bow at each other. They will be standing in bus stop, they will be very respectfully bowing at each other. But as soon as the bus arrives, these bowing gentlemen are transformed into savages. Savages means, it is like, as soon as the bus comes, they become fierce. As soon as the bus comes, They become savage or they become fierce. They push each other aside, tread on each other's toes, and shove others' elbows into each other's stomachs. He's telling that as soon as bus come, they become savages and they start pushing each other and they start treading on each other's toes. They stamp on each other's toes. They try to show their elbows into others, try to push their elbows into others' stomach, and they run inside the bus to get seat. Same like the deer, what it did. The deer, why is he telling that the deer is like a true Japanese? He's telling the deer first what it did, it bowed in front of him. After that, it jumped and took the food packet and it ran away. Same like that, he is telling, they stand in the bus stop, bow at each other, full respect. As soon as the bus comes, they become fierce, they push, stamp, pull each other, and they get into the bus. So this is what humorously the author is trying to say. Now the next, a small description he is giving about another habit of the Japanese, that is eating soup. Okay, another habit, that is eating soup. So what does he say about this habit? Eating soup has more dangers than almost anything else. So he is telling that eating soup has more dangers. These Japanese people, eating soup has more dangers. When eating soup, you must make a fearful noise. So when you are eating soup or maybe drinking soup, you have to make a fearful noise. See, usually you should not make noise when you are eating. But here he is telling that when you are eating, you should make a fearful noise. It is a sign of appreciation. So a fearful noise, here he is telling that it is a sign of appreciation. It is a sign of praising the person who has made the soup. If you don't make the noise, so if you don't make this fearful noise, your hostess or the woman or the person who has prepared the soup will think, what an ill-mannered person. If you don't, they will think that you are an ill-mannered lout. That is, you are ill-mannered, an aggressive person. But if you do, if you make a fearful noise, she will think, no reasonably well-brought up European makes such a disgusting noise. So if you make noise also problem, if you don't make also problem. If you don't make, she will think you are a very ill-mannered person. If you make noise, she will think, no well brought up European will make such a noise. If he is a well brought up European, he will not make such a noise, will not make such a disgusting noise when eating soup. He must be an ill-mannered lout. That is, if you make noise also, you will be thought as an ill-mannered person. If you don't make noise also, you will be thought as an ill-mannered person. So he is telling that that is why eating soup is a very dangerous thing than almost everything else, because if you make noise, she will think you are an ill-mannered person. If you don't make noise also, she will think you are an ill-mannered person. So that is why the author is telling eating soup is more dangerous than anything else. So this much is the part in which the author explains about Japanese manners. So as I have told in the beginning, this excerpt about Japanese manners is from the book. The book's name is The Land of the Rising Yen. Okay, yen is the Japanese currency. So the next part is about Brazil, that is traffic in Brazil. So the second part I will be continuing in the next video. So I hope you have understood this part very clearly. If you have any doubts regarding this, you can ask in the comment section. And also, don't forget to like, share and subscribe to my channel. Your likes and shares will be of a great encouragement for me to make more and more videos. So I hope to see you all soon in the coming video. Thank you for watching.